Good morning, everyone. My name is Mehmet Aydın Baytaş. I'm going to talk to you today about drones as a design material. And specifically, we're going to talk about interactive drones. And even more specifically, this is going to be autonomous or semi-autonomous close-range interactive drones as a design material. That's what we're going to talk about. And I'm not going to bore you with statistics about like how many drones there are in the world and so on. I'm just going to straight up show you what this looks like in action. When you actually make a design material out of a drone, it looks like this. This is a project which is led and mostly executed by a collaborator of mine from Australia. His name is Joseph LaDelfa. And he's a PhD student at RMIT, the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology in Melbourne, obviously, in Australia. And he made this project called Drone Chi, which I think is a wonderful demonstration, illustration of what drones as a design material means to me. And we will get back to this project in the following minutes. But before we do that, I want to tell you a bit about myself, perhaps, since this is the first time we meet, to perhaps like establish some of my qualifications, like why am I talking to you about this and why you should listen to what I say about this topic. I'm from Istanbul, I'm Turkish, and I currently live in Gothenburg in Sweden. I am affiliated with Chalmers University of Technology at their Joint Department of Computer Science and Engineering. Which is it's a joint organization together with the University of Gothenburg. The professor that I work with over here, who has founded and manages the research lab where I work in, is Professor Morten Fjeld, and he's actually also a lecturer, a professor at the University of Bergen. So that's how I came into contact with Tien and with this course, and that's how that connection began. I have a PhD in something called design technology and society. To be honest, I'm mostly concerned with the design part of this and also somewhat with the technology part and not as much as those with the society part, but it was a very interdisciplinary department and there were other people working on media sociology and different sort of social sciences topics in my department. So I was fortunate enough to be there at Koç University in Istanbul doing that. And before that, I had studied mechanical engineering and economics. And outside of those, I kind of specialized in software within mechanical engineering. So control software and user interfaces and so on. And I then carried that over to working with user experience design and user interfaces. So these days I am specializing in, so I belong in this research community or discipline called human-computer interaction. And within that, I'd like to do work in a sort of field of that called interaction design. It intersects very much with sort of design, which includes like things like graphic design, motion design, typography, web design, all kinds of things. By the way, what departments do you belong to? Can you say in the chat what particular major or program or department you're from? I think that would help me position some of my wording for you better. So I work with these topics that I like to call physical and spatial computing, and I like to work with these philosophies or approaches or sort of schools of thought which relate to the notion of embodiment. So the notion that humans process information not only cognitively, but we also perceive, interact, and process information through our bodies, through the entire physicality of our being. I like to use this sort of philosophical approach called soma aesthetics in my work, especially more recently. And I will get back to those also later. But in order to serve these goals, in order to serve these themes, I work with emerging technologies. So these have been in the past computer vision and blockchain and augmented reality and those things. And more recently, I've been working with interactive drones. In the future, it will change. In the future, I might be working with something else. But for now, my main project has to do with interactive drones. And this, in my opinion, has some very interesting possibilities for embodied interaction, physical computing and spatial computing. I think drones are a wonderful technology, a wonderful design material, which can be used for these purposes. And I not only make gadgets, I actually make very few gadgets and very few designs, but what I like to do most often is making design tools. So tools and processes and philosophies and so on to serve other designers and hackers and hobbyists to lower the barriers for other people, students even, such as yourselves, who might want to work with these technologies. So both physical, technological things and ideas to serve these people who might be creating with emerging technologies. That's sort of my goal. Today, I'm going to talk to you about interactive drones. As I said, I'm roughly going to tell you the story of how I came to be involved with this topic and sort of my adventure in this topic. And in telling you that in sort of a quasi-chronological order, I hope to also reveal to you some interesting information about how drones are controlled and what sort of physical engineering considerations are relevant for interactive drones and the state of the art in terms of what people are accomplishing doing with them. I will talk a little bit about our project, one of my favorite projects, which is, as I said, led by my Australian colleague, Joseph LaDelfa. I will tell you a little bit about design philosophies and why they might be useful. And I will tell you about our most recent project, for which we got significant amounts of funding, and it's our main focus as a team these days. So I want to begin with a question. If you want to study, do experiments, do research with close-range human-drone interaction, what do you need? What is required? Like, can you give me a list of things you would need to have in order to do these experiments and studies and research? So what are some, what's a list of ingredients? What's a list of required things for you to do? Can you just throw this in the chat in Zoom? I'll wait until a couple of people throw in some ideas. You need a drone? Yes, definitely. That's on the list. What else? I'll give you a hint. It's in the, you need a human, of course, and something to control the drone. That's really good. So I have made this list actually. And space. Wow, you actually told me everything on the list. So you need a human, you need a drone, you need the space in which the drone is going to fly. And the reason you need the space, and preferably an enclosed space, is that drones which are small enough to fly in close range and be comfortable for people are not very good at flying outdoors because the wind conditions will blow them off. These are very small drones. They can't deal with wind very well. In addition to these, you need a positioning and control system. So I don't know if you've heard of the notion of the Rodriguez list. This is something I encountered in a couple of books that I read recently, and it's due to the filmmaker Robert Rodriguez, who's made a bunch of interesting movies. I think El Mariachi was one of his first movies, it's very famous. Machete, I think, was one of his more recent. He makes these very, action-packed, almost low-budget aesthetic, really interesting movies. With really interesting stories and really interesting aesthetics. He's a very accomplished filmmaker. And his principle is that he starts making his movies with a list of things that he has already. If you go to the Wikipedia page for Robert Rodriguez, you can actually find a few sentences about this approach. But basically, you sit down and you make a list of all the things you have. And then you sort of, if you're making a movie, you write your story or your script for your movie based on what you have. So the story of Robert Rodriguez with El Mariachi, for example, one of his first movies was that I think he had a friend who had a nice house, he had a car, and he had this other friend who wanted to be in a movie, and he made a list of all of these things, and then he wrote the entire movie script based on those things in order to utilize those things. So that's what happened to me a few years ago when I found myself working with a motion capture company who have this space in their office. So this is a motion capture company that makes the actual motion capture technology. They create the software and the camera systems for 3D position and motion detection. This is technology which is used very often in movie making, but also has applications in physiotherapy and various other medical purposes and machine control, robot control. And as you can see in this picture, on the ceiling, there are these trusses which have cameras attached, right? So these cameras are a positioning system. They are a motion capture system. When you combine this with a little drone, which is also, incidentally, this particular model, this was made by, again, a Swedish company, which is quite close to Gothenburg. They're located in Malmö. They are called Bitcraze, and they make these little tiny quadcopters. So if you combine that positioning system with this kind of little drone and put these little markers on the drone, which enable 3D position tracking in, with 6 degrees of freedom, so you can get rotations as well as the actual, you know, translational position of this gadget in 3D, you have yourself all of the ingredients you need to do drone studies and to build interactive experiences with these drones. This drone is tiny, by the way. I placed the little USB connector which goes into it in the background for scale. So I think it's like 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters in dimensions between the rotors. And it's very comfortable to have around, flying around. I think you guys work with the DJI Tello. Tian has told me that. And the Tello is a wonderful platform, but even the Tello is a little, it's not the most comfortable thing to have flying around in your home. Like if you have papers lying around or other like lightweight things, they will start flying around because of the airflow. So this little thing, because it's so small, and unfortunately I don't have one of them in my home right now. I wish I did, but it's tiny. So it's very comfortable to fly close to you. I'll show you a video of how it flies and how accurate and stable the position tracking and control can be when you have this motion capture system. So this is a little control demonstration where I think this guy is one of the developers at Bitcraze. He traces this path between the legs of the tripod and drops the drone in there, and the drone just follows the same path. So you can record the path and play it back with the drone with superb precision and accuracy. There's very little error in positioning. There's no drift. You don't have like a lot of the sort of control problems that you would have with lesser positioning systems. So that's the technology that we had. And using this kind of technology, you can do a lot of different kinds of studies. Like in the past, for example, when people studied this kind of human drone interaction at close range, they looked at things like, you know, proxemics, like how do people, so proxemics is the study of distance and space and how it figures in the communication between people in social relations. And people applied this concept to human-robot interaction, did studies with ground robots, and then later adapted those for studies with flying robots, with drones. So we looked into these kinds of studies, and I actually worked together with some of these people who've done these things, like Morten Fjeld, as I said, and Mohammed Obaid, who's now an associate professor at Chalmers. So we all work together right now. They had done these studies in the past. We also looked at like other studies where people looked at how, again, like things like proximity, direction, movements of the drone, how these are interpreted and how these can be used in some sort of interaction, how these can have meaning as part of an interactive system. People have looked at gesture control of drones and what are some natural hand movements that you might want to do to your drone in order to give commands to it. So you can say like stop, you can, you know, say come over here, you can say like go there. People have studied these actions and investigated what people prefer to do in order to issue these commands. And our system that we had was able to do all of these things. Like this is, for example, a screenshot from the actual software that that does the position tracking and drone control. And we even actually published a little paper about this whole apparatus, this whole setup, and documenting the possibilities. So you can have drone tracking, you can track the hands and feet and heads, you can track any point on the human, you can have eye tracking with a gaze vector inside of the same 3D space, everything is calibrated, everything is super precise. So we have this setup, and we wanted to do research with it, right? So our goal at first was to do empirical research, user experience studies and experiments with actual designs. I imagine that since you are from the media and interaction design department, you've probably heard these words before. Can you nod if you have, or say yes in the chat or something? So you know what these mean. So we wanted to do some of these, where you actually build a system and invite people into your lab, and they use it, and they give you their opinions, or you like time them doing something, or fill out, you know, check out other criteria, and evaluate the system and so on. And we basically just couldn't decide what to do. Like I have two problems when it comes to doing designs and empirical studies. The first problem I have is that I'm extremely careful with how I use other people's time. So if I'm going to invest, you know, like 50 hours of my time and like 1 or 2 hours each of my participants into coming into my lab and doing a study, I really want to be sure that what I'm doing will be valuable, that it matters, that it's worth doing. The other thing is that I really want to make sure that it's relevant to the research community that I'm working in. I just want to study this thing exhaustively before I go to action. I want to do my desk research very thoroughly. So I started doing that before I did the UX research. And I noticed that in the literature, there's a particular segment of drones, a particular class of use cases with drones, which we can call social drones. So most drone systems, most drone applications today, they involve a pilot, right? A lot of commercial drone applications, especially like photography, inspection, have a pilot who uses a drone to access somewhere that they can't really go themselves. So you send it high up so you can take pictures from above. You send it into a cave or into a dangerous place, into the sort of fire to extinguish the fire, or you send it somewhere you can't go. So that's most drone applications, and that's depicted in the lower left quadrant over here. What we wanted to look at was drones in human populated environments which behave autonomously. So not piloted drones, and not drones in remote spaces where humans can't access, but we wanted to investigate the use of drones in populated areas where they exist together with humans but behave autonomously, where there's no pilot. So in order to do this, we basically sat down and read all of the studies that anyone did, as far as we could find. I'm sure we missed a few things, but we read all of the studies there are on this topic of social drones, autonomous drones without pilots flying near humans. And then we decided to sort of construct this like map of the knowledge space, where we identified what kinds of research topics or themes are people working on, what kinds of learnings did they extract from this from their studies, what kinds of methods did they use, and so on. And by doing that, we produced this map of the design space. The reason we did this was even before we sort of designed the gadgets, we wanted to have a good idea of like what other people have found before us in this topic, right? So what do we already know about designing these social drones? In the end, we ended up with, first of all, a map of the knowledge that we have on social drones, things like information that, let's say, multiple studies have independently found out and corroborated, so that we can assume that is a fact, and we can assume that is the truth when we're designing drones. And we also had a map of the design space. And that means we had a map of the considerations for designing drones, like what can you modify when you're working with a drone? What are the things that you have control over as a designer or developer, and what do they result in? So for example, control methods and flight and the shape, the form of the drone, the lights and displays on the drone, and the proxemic behaviors and the sounds. These are things that you can manipulate as a designer. So we call them drone design concerns. And in turn, they influence these things that we call human-centered concerns, which are things that you can't really control, but you want to control. So you modulate these things based on how you design with these drone design concerns. So if you want to have a particular result in terms of the intuitiveness of the control method or the tactility perception, which is how much people perceive a drone as something they can touch or grab, there are particular manipulations, particular design choices that you can make in this list on the left, which influence those things in particular ways. So we ended up with a information source which reveals those connections, those design considerations when it comes to social drones. We actually published this review. So this is a paper that we published last year at the CAI conference, the Human Factors Conference of ACM, the Association for Computing Machinery, which is one of the top venues for human-computer interaction and interaction design research. The purpose of this was to actually serve as a starting point for researchers, for designers and developers who are working with social drones, with interactive drones as a design material. The intended purpose of this paper was to be the paper that I wish I had when we began our work. So we wrote it, and it also consolidates the knowledge and reveals where individual studies have agreed and disagreed when it comes to how you design these artifacts and how you use this design material. I have to also give a hat tip to my friend Dante Tezza, who in a similar time frame produced and published another literature review on human-drone interaction. So if you're working with drones as a design material, I think these two papers, ours and Dante's, are the best starting points that you can go to. The difference between them is Dante and his colleague Marvin, they concern themselves with drones more generally and human-drone interaction more generally. So they look at flying with the controller, piloted drones, racing and photography and all of these use cases where a pilot is involved. But we concentrate on these autonomous use cases where a pilot isn't involved, but the drone is flying close to other humans. These things you can find in the on the internet. You can go to my website and find a link to the PDF of our paper, or you could go to the IEEE and ACM digital libraries and find these resources and have a look. If you are going to read one paper for your research or design work on human-drone interaction and interactive drones, I would suggest that you start with one of these because that was the purpose for which we produce these things. But then inside of these things, there's a lot of really impressive work going on in these fields. And I will briefly summarize the content of what we did and touch upon some of those things. So first of all, we looked at what kinds of topics, what kinds of reasons are people using interactive drones, social drones? What kinds of use cases or research themes are people involved in? We identified a particular cluster of research, which we called communication, control, and comfort, where people have looked at how abstract movements or control methods are interpreted, what people like and don't like, you know, what is the meaning of it if the drone sort of starts shaking itself in the air, what is it if it flies in circles, what does it mean if it comes close to you, how do people intuitively interpret these things, and how do they prefer to use these notions in controlling the drones. So that was the purpose of this cluster of research, and you can go in this paper that we published and look at other papers inside of this cluster and other findings people have as well. There was a second cluster where people concentrated more on use cases. So what are they actually useful for, these interactive drones? And the primary themes here were navigation, assistance, and companionship. So navigation is where, for example, you have a drone in the air, as in this picture, which projects directions on the ground where you walk. So instead of having your cell phone and, you know, like looking at a map as you're walking, you have a drone flying in front of you, and it's showing you the way by projecting arrows on the ground. Another example is a study that some of my colleagues and their other teammates have done regarding social drones in a home environment. So they studied people's preferences. So, and they did some studies even in VR, which I think was very innovative. So they built drone prototypes in virtual reality, which people could watch and interact with. And they realized that, like, if you want to have a drone in your home, what should it do? What are some useful things that it could be serving? What are some useful interaction methods that you can use to interact with this thing, and so on? A third cluster concerned with innovative applications and HCI, so using the drone as a user interface. There are some very interesting prototypes and studies where people built haptic effects in virtual reality with drones, for example. There are some other interesting studies where people built graspable drones. I will show you a video of one of these. I think this is perhaps the definitive work when it comes to drones in drones as a user interface. This is done by a research group in Canada at Queen's University, which is led by Professor Roel Vertigal. The people who actually did these things, I think their names are Calvin Rubens and it's if you look at the citation that was in this in the beginning of this video, you can see it. It's called Bit Drones. Gomez, I think Antonio Gomez and Calvin Rubens and Sean Braley, they are the team who built this thing. And this is, I think, the definitive application of drones as a user interface, where you can move them around and project graphics on the drone and use the lights on the drone for interaction and so on. You can see, by the way, that it's exactly the same kind of motion capture technology that is used for constructing this application that we had. So we had the same technology, but these people obviously had a little bit of a head start. But then, after we figured out the map of the knowledge, we wanted a map of the design space, right? So people like yourselves, students, designers, hackers, developers, if you want to work with drones, what are the things that you should pay attention to? What are the parameters, design choices that you can make in order to build drone applications that serve the purposes you intend to serve? So we looked at control methods like voice, gesture, and external devices. But you can manipulate flight patterns and movements and stance and directions of the drone in order to convey certain messages to the people who are in the same room with the drone. You can change the size, shape, color of the drone, add little appendages, lights, and things on top of it. You can use proxemics is a very basic interaction modality where the drone means something if it's far away, and if it's close, then it's supposed to behave differently. You can experiment with sounds on the drone, which can be produced by speakers through like synthesis and sampling, but they can also be mechanical sounds of the propellers of the drone itself. So I'll not cover all of these in detail, but I will zoom in into three human-centered concerns, which is to say three kinds of outcomes that you can achieve by manipulating these parameters, these design concerns, this kind of design space in particular ways. So the first of those categories, which we call human-centered concerns, is appeal. So if you produce this drone as a product, are people going to actually like this? Will they buy it? Will they use it? Will they spend time with it? Do they feel safe when they're interacting with this drone? Do they believe that this drone will not cause them harm? It's not going to crash into their head and harm them and so on. So we found out through reading multiple studies that it's pretty well established. There's a good degree of consensus when it comes to designing drones that an appealing drone is small, calm, quiet, slow, and smooth, and all of those things. So if you're going to take away one thing from this presentation, I'm going to tell you that right now. If you want to learn one thing that directly influences what you're doing with a drone, how you design a interactive application, it is this: go slow. Limit the speed of your drone. If you're working with a drone that's supposed to fly in close range, you want it to move very slowly. And there are also engineering reasons why this is the case. Because if you go fast, then the behavior of the dynamic system means, like, if you're trying to reach a particular point, then your drone, if it's going fast, is going to first overshoot that point and then try to come back and then sort of do this like little jittery motion. But if you go slow, that overshoot is going to be minimized and you're going to like slowly converge into the desired location and things. So if you've studied engineering dynamics and control, this notion will be very familiar to you. But it has a very direct impact on the user experience, where people really don't like drones that are going fast, drones that are large, drones that are loud around them. And also you should consider bystanders. So a lot of drone applications, they're built, or a lot of human computer interaction and design applications, they're built with a single user in mind. But it's very important, some of these studies have shown, to consider the bystanders who might not be interacting with your drone, but they're there in the same room with it. So it matters how much noise your drone is making and how much sort of movement it's making in the space. Another dimension which is significant is how intuitive is communication and control with the drone. So how can people who have no experience, who have read no documentation, who have seen no explanation, when they get in the same room with this drone, do they understand what it's doing? Do they understand that they should maybe step aside? Or do they understand and sort of feel safe that the drone will not come and crash into them? So for this, you want your drone to be directional, for example. You want a design with a clear front and the back. I think the Tello platform that you're using does a fairly good job in this. But the CrazyFly that we're using, for example, readily out of the box, it doesn't do as good a job in its aesthetics. So we, in order to establish this kind of feeling, we sometimes need to develop like custom claddings and 3D printings on top of it. But sometimes also maybe you want to have a feeling of mystery. So it's okay to break the rules as long as you know what rules are for. As a side note, I like to say that rules are for people who don't understand what rules are for. So if you know what rules are for, then you can break the rules of design, you can break the rules of engineering and everything, and still achieve your desired outcomes. But you really have to have a very sophisticated understanding of why the rules are there in order to do that properly. So again, smooth, stable behavior, directional drones, this is preferred for people to be able to intuitively understand drones. But the fidelity of this channel of communication, when you're using drone lights or movements, you know, communicating things about the drone to people without any documentation or explanation or anything, this is very low fidelity. The actual sophistication, the complexity of the messages that you can give is very, very, very limited. And it's also very culture dependent. You know, in some cultures, if you move from side to side, it means no. In some cultures, it means yes. So you have to be considerate. You have to be mindful who will use this and what cultures it will be deployed in. And maybe if you're designing a drone for Scandinavia versus a drone for China, you might want to consider having it move in different ways in order to convey certain messages. Another interesting finding was that a lot of people perceive drones and also other social robots as... Maybe I misspoke, so I don't want to say they perceive them as animals, but they use an animal analogy, an animal metaphor, in order to make sense of the actions of the drone or the robot, and in order to find sort of intuitive ways of controlling the drone. So a pet metaphor or a pet analogy is actually a great basis for interpretation and control if you're designing social drones for close range interactions. We also found that people, for example, prefer training a social robot over time rather than directly controlling it. Just as you train a dog or a pet, you know, you start, I've actually never trained a dog, so I don't really know, but I'm imagining you actually repeat the same commands and give rewards when you see the, you know, expected results, and you don't give a reward when you don't see the result you want. And hence, over time, the dog learns what to do when you say sit or when you say, you know, run or something like that. And interestingly, attachment and sort of emotional bonding is very common in the case of all social robots, but also in social drones. So you might want to consider these dimensions, these parameters, if you're working on sort of leisure applications or toys or things like that. So this brings me to this little guy. So as I said, we had this equipment, we were working with it when we uncovered all of this knowledge and so on. And simultaneously, my collaborator and friend, Joseph LaDelfa in Australia, was also working with exactly the same platform. And he designed this thing that he called Drone Chi, which is a very sort of interesting design. I don't have time to cover all of its parameters, but we did publish multiple papers about the user experience and the design process. And there's even like 3D exploded view drawings, technical drawings of the thing, which you can use to sort of inspire and inform your own work in some of these publications. So he built this experience called Drone Chi, which is actually very inspired by Tai Chi. So he started out learning Tai Chi and trying to replicate some of the movements and some of the feelings that you get when you're practicing Tai Chi in a drone interaction. And the end result is this this interactive experience, which captures a lot of the feelings, a lot of the intentions in a Tai Chi exercise, but you're doing it together with a drone. It's mostly based on open source software. There's a particular open source software that Bitgraze themselves published for drone control. And I think the algorithm for this particular application is maybe 2 lines of code added on top of that. So it's very, very much based on available tools. But I think it's a genius design because it illustrates a lot of the considerations that I was talking about. It's a small drone. It flies very slowly and very smoothly. It's it's designed with consideration to the particular effect that you might want to have. So it's integrated, for example, when it's standing still, when the system is off. It has like a charging dock that you see in the lower right over here, which is shaped and designed like a vine. So the drone is shaped like a flower and it docks into this like leafy vine kind of setup where it charges. And there's also lights going on, which are not very apparent in this picture. So I think this is pure design genius. And this is how you design with interactive drones as a design material. I'm very fortunate, very happy to be collaborating with Joe and contributing to this project myself also. But I want to use this project as a little sort of segue into talking about some design philosophies very briefly. And a lot of people see philosophy as something that's not really super useful. So that's why I picked this meme. You know, it sort of illustrates this like philosophical thoughts, which really doesn't seem to have any use at all. But I think some philosophical constructs, some theoretical ideas are very useful, and they're very useful for 2 things. One of them is to, if you want to publish and produce academic work, so you're expected to sort of situate your work in the previous ideas and previous work that's come before it and exhibit a high level of sophistication and so on. And engaging with philosophical thoughts and theoretical constructs is a very easy way to do that. The second thing is when you're designing. You know, design is about making decisions, imposing constraints. And when you start with a particular sort of theoretical or philosophical space, which is reasonably constrained to guide your designs, which is given by philosophical and theoretical ideas in design, then I think that's a great starting point. So I want to very briefly tell you about 4 philosophical or theoretical ideas that guide my work in designing with interactive drones. And I'll tell you why they're relevant, and I'll give you 2 resources each. One of them is a great starting point. So if you've never heard of this, this is where you should start. The second is the definitive resource. This is like the thing that you have to read, you have to be aware of if you're, let's say, publishing an academic paper, but maybe it's too much reading for a small project. The first of these is Soma Aesthetics, which is a philosophical project that aims to integrate bodily knowledge. So it aims to integrate practices like Tai Chi and yoga and Feldenkrais and physiotherapy and the knowledge involved in these practices with philosophical ideas. In design, this is actually deployed in human-computer interaction and interaction design, where it has informed particular ways of designing, particular design methods. So there's a particular, let's say, movement in interaction design, which says, okay, we build on the ideas of Soma aesthetics, and these are the design methods and approaches and ways of doing things that result from that. If you want to have an introduction to this thing, I think you can start with our paper on the Drone Chi project, where we use this philosophy extensively, and we talk extensively in the paper about how this is deployed. And if you want the definitive research, Christina Hoek from Kataho in Stockholm has written a book about this subject a few years ago. I highly recommend that one. Embodied interaction, as I mentioned before, is the notion that a lot of knowledge and information processing is embedded in our physicality, in our physical bodies, in our physical perception, in the physical world around us. For that, you can go to my website, and in my publications, you can find my PhD thesis and read chapter 2, which is actually very short and I hope, very accessible. And if it's not, you know, send me a message on Twitter and say that, you know, I suck as a writer. But it's meant to be really accessible and really short and sort of a designerly or a good introduction into this topic for designers and hackers and engineers. If you want a definitive resource, again, there's a book by Paul Dourish. There is the notion of entanglement in HCI, which builds on post-humanism and other ideas, which I find really interesting. And I actually disagree very much with some of the things that this idea is saying, but I think at its core, it's a very interesting idea. If you want to be introduced to it, you can follow the link on the slide onto Christopher Frauenberger's site. And he has a video where he introduces this idea. The definitive resource is a longer paper by him, which is also, it's published in the Transactions on Human-Computer Interaction journal. And finally, the notion of agent archetypes. So there are varying degrees of autonomy that AI agents and robots and computers might have, right? So people have written about this topic in a paper where they explore this concept called objects with intent, which is objects that are meant to be perceived not as beings or like sentient sort of AI, real intelligent things, but still objects, but they have some agency, they have some intent and potentials for collaborating with human intelligence. We explored this idea in a recent workshop paper, applying it to the notion of interactive drones, but the definitive research is a longer paper from a year earlier. So these are some philosophical ideas that I like, which I think are interesting for designing with social drones, with interactive drones. And now, recently, we've been engaged in this sort of larger scale research project, which is funded by a sort of nonprofit in Sweden, which funds AI research projects. And we're looking at design considerations for how drones in the future, or how the current technology even, might integrate with our daily lives in a considerate, thoughtful manner. When you look at the project documentation, when you look at the, you know, how we describe it in the documentation, it says it's investigating how social drones should behave and how our societies should respond to this technology and so on. But I actually don't like this description very much. I prefer another approach, even though I wrote most of the project documentation and I sort of came up with the original description of how it should be. I don't prefer it for some reasons. Can you guess which exact word in this description of investigating how social drones should be? Can you guess which word I do not prefer and what I will replace it with? So can you throw out a word in the chat? Like, you have 6 choices. Which one would I like to change? Yeah, should, exactly. I mean, it's highlighted, right? So instead of should, I like to explore how things might be. And this is actually also even in the project title, because this is about constructive design research, where you investigate things by making things, by creating, doing things. Because I believe from like an existential philosophy point of view, I guess, like before you do it, before something exists in the world, it's not as valuable to talk about it and debate about it. So the most valuable thing you can do if you want to have a debate about technology and if you want to explore the implications and considerations around a particular technology, the best thing you can do is to actually build it, to prototype it and experience it. So we're working with we're at the earlier stages of this project right now, but we're working with some interesting approaches. Some of these are really ridiculous and artistic. Like one of our PhD students, one of my colleagues is working on like these artistic sort of illustrations and impressions of these ridiculous tasks that drones might do in your home, for example. And eventually we're going to work on turning these into actual prototypes. So this is one example where you might have a drone in your home, you know, bringing things like toothbrush to you and dispensing toothbrush on your, toothpaste on your toothbrush. And these are some of these are really ridiculous. Like some of these are not meant to be serious. These are speculative design approaches. So if you look in the literature for like speculative design fiction, and these things, these approaches as a research method, actually working with ridiculous things and challenging existing conventions, this is well documented and is kind of an established research field by now. But by doing these things, by producing these ideas and by prototyping them, you actually also investigate technologies and design considerations which are relevant for real-world valuable applications. So the positioning technologies and the technological explorations that we do with these kinds of ridiculous concepts in turn can power things like GPS-denied drone, you know, positioning, indoor 3D mapping inspection scenarios, which are very relevant for industrial use cases in construction, mining, and so on. In cinematography, people are doing very innovative drone applications, which might actually benefit from some of the explorations that we're doing with these technologies. Assistive technologies for blind people, where drones can be used to perform some of the tasks that animals, dogs, for example, are performing for them, or other sort of scouting possibilities if your mobility is impaired. We're obviously looking at novel UIs, such as in the videos that I showed you earlier, information visualization and other robotic actuation possibilities with drones, sports and games and exercise and even meditation. These well-being applications are very relevant, in my opinion, when you have a platform that's able to like move around and you can sense the human body and human movements and track it and control it with them. And obviously toys. Like one of the most important things that I want to do as a result of this project is a toy for cats. I think it has great potential as a commercial project even. But these are the kinds of applications which might be informed by the kinds of ridiculous things that we want to do in more artistic applications. This goes back also, like one of the things I want to accomplish in this project, it also goes back to the original, the list, right? What do you need in order to study drone applications? There's one more thing on this list, which is not on the list right now. Can you guess what it is? One very, very important ingredient in order to build, study drone designs and drone applications. What might that be? Throw me some words. And I see in the chat also that someone has thought about cats drones before. I think that's a wonderful idea. I didn't even come up with this idea. It was told to me by three different people independently who own cats. Cat owners have demanded this product from me. But like, just throw some words, like one more ingredient. What might that be? What is missing on this list? If you want to, curiosity, you're getting warm. You're getting close. That's very close. Who has curiosity? What would you call a person who is curious? Or what would be a skill or a capability that arises from curiosity? Research. Okay, that's close. But The answer I'm looking for, the main ingredient that you need if you want to do this kind of work, is an engineer or hacker. You need someone who can find their way around technology. You really need someone who knows what they're doing in like Python or with embedded electronics or, you know, whatever programming environment that passes for the particular drone that you're using. You need someone who can set up the physical system, put together the electronics, put together the camera systems and all of that, and configure, calibrate the systems, all of these things. You need one of these people. So what I want to do in this project, in order to carry this field, this topic further and contribute to this pool of knowledge, is to get rid of most of these requirements. So I want to get rid of the space, I want to get rid of the positioning system, and I want to get rid of the engineer. And using only a single human who is not qualified, maybe, or who's not interested in extensive engineering or hacking on these systems, and the particular drone, I want to lower the barriers of constructing, building drone applications and designing with them and trying them out. So this, I think, is an important thing to do in order to explore this field further and realize the potentials of interactive drones as a design material. So now we're going a little into future and current work that we're doing. And I will show you an example. So we haven't actually done this work yet, but I will show you an example of what it will look like when it's done. So this is the user interface for the control system, which actually controls the actual drone that we actually use right now. So this is what it looks like on the screen. As you can see, it's a lot of numbers, dropdowns, degrees, radians, you know, millimeters, graphs. So the blue and black thing in the middle is actually like a visualization of the rotation of the drone in space, kind of like what you get in an airplane cockpit. So this is the kind of interface, the user interface that we're dealing with. And like, even like to customize this, to build our custom behaviors, we actually need to go into the code of this user interface and modify the actual Python code. What I want it to look like is something more like this. This is an application that I built for my master's thesis in 2014. And this is for programming the Microsoft Kinect. If you don't know what that is some kind of camera that Microsoft used to make, which is able to sense in 3D, in three dimensions, human body movements. So the blue skeleton thing that you see in the pictures right here, that is actually a camera image. That is a real-time 3D moving human skeleton that is detected from a human who steps away from the camera, stands in front of it, and moves around, and the skeleton tracks their movements. And I built this programming interface where by coloring in little blocks, little squares, and by building those into 3D voxels or these 3D grid elements and arranging them in a timeline as keyframes, doing everything visually, you can program gesture recognition. No code involved whatsoever. And we sort of tried this out with designers and in design education settings, and this works really well. And the way that this works is that you program a gesture, a particular movement, and you map it to a keyboard command so that when you do the swipe movement, for example, the computer recognizes a swipe and relays the space key or any of the keys on your keyboard that goes to whatever application you're running on your system. So I do this and PowerPoint changes my slide. I, you know, do these punching movements and play a game with those things. I can move my hand around the space and control the arrow keys and play games and so on. So this was my master's project back in the day for gesture recognition. And the goal right now, one of the goals we have right now, is to do the same kind of graphical programming, visual programming interface for drones, which will enable people like you and other designers to create with them. So lowering the barriers. To do this, we need some additional skills and we need some additional people. So if you would like to contribute to this project, either by perhaps traveling to Gothenburg and working with us, or working remotely, working from Bergen, if you have Python and Unity development skills, if you have skills in PCB design and fabrication, 3D modeling, 3D printing, if you're interested in doing empirical design research, running user studies with these technologies, you can contact me. and we can arrange opportunities for you to work with us, and we can learn from each other in the process. So that's all that I have to say on the topic of interactive drones as a design material. If you have time, I can take any questions you want. I can turn off the recording if you like to speak with your actual voice.